today we're really going to dive into what it means to build your teaching portfolio. The session's being recorded, so you should get an alert about that. My name is Shed, like the thing in your backyard. I go by she or they pronouns, and I'm a teaching and learning specialist at the CTRL. I'm going to pass it to Gavin and then Hannah to introduce themselves as well.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Gavin Frome. I use they, them pronouns, and I'm a graduate assistant working with the teaching and learning team at CTRL. And thank you all very much for joining us today. Always excited to talk about teaching portfolios.
And hello, everyone. I'm Hannah Jardine, also a teaching and learning specialist at the Center for Teaching Research and Learning, as well as an adjunct instructor in the School of Education.
All right, so we're going to get started today what's our next slide? Let's see. With our warm-up chat, thank you. Okay, in the chat, if you don't mind introducing yourselves, if you want to include your pronouns, please feel free, your department or your unit where you call home on campus, and then share what do you already know about teaching portfolios, and then what do you want to know about teaching portfolios. So a little bit about you and where you're from at AU, and then tell us kind of a little bit about what you know about portfolios and what you want to know. Less a minute to do some typing. All right, I've already got one person who says, not much, which is perfect. You're in the perfect place. Yes, glad you came. Yeah, where else are we in the process right now? And it's okay if you feel very experienced with them or not experienced at all. All right. Oh, so we've got a person who is going to be rank and promotion chair in their unit, which is a great reason to learn more about them. Ideas about items to include. Right. But what do we include and how are they helpful? Absolutely. We're going to talk about that a little bit. But yeah, recently completed first teaching portfolio. Awesome. But want to make it better. Want to know everything. All right. These are wonderful. So please feel free to keep sharing. Glad to see that folks are excited to learn about this topic. We're not going to go over everything in perfect detail, but we're going to get the conversation started and we're going to focus on a couple important components. So we're ready for our next part, which is our guidelines. So throughout this workshop, especially considering it's kind of a longer one for us, we kindly ask that you be present, participate in individual and group activities in the way that's going to work for you today. Ask questions or share ideas in the chat. So we want to hear from you. What have you worked on? What ideas do you have? What questions can we answer? Use the raise hand function to speak so we can see that you want to speak so we can call on you. Please be generous with your knowledge. So, you know, we want to learn from each other and be respectful of others' knowledge. So everyone's coming in with different experiences and perspectives, and we want to acknowledge and validate all of those perspectives. And then we're striving to make it an active, brave space. So that's something that we'll establish together by working together. And let us know any questions about that along the way. So our outcomes are basically our agenda for the session. By the end of the workshop, what our outcomes are, you'll be able to describe the purpose and components of the teaching portfolio at AU. Keeping in mind, teaching portfolios look different everywhere. We're really trying to focus on what makes them successful in the space of AU. Draft an outline of a teaching philosophy statement, which is sort of tends to be the center of the portfolio, as we'll discuss. And then develop a plan to gather evidence of self-peer and student assessment and other materials that are relevant to a teaching portfolio. So that's sort of the order that we're going to go in today. And we're going to start with this question of what is a teaching portfolio? Pretty good question, right? We've got three components that we're going to think about today. The purpose of the portfolio, why even write it, why even make it. The format, so how should it be organized? How should it be presented to the audience? And then what are the components? What do you actually have to include in there? Do you need a statement? Do you need artifacts? Do you need a syllabus? We're going to talk about that. All right. So this is still me, right? I got worried that I was running over. Okay, sorry. All right, purpose and format. Why create a portfolio in the first place? So I saw some reasons in the chat from people. Does anyone want to add any reasons why we might create a portfolio? I mean, we know we have to make one, right? But why even bother? Yeah, Elizabeth, please go ahead.
I feel like during the semester, I'm in the just go, go, go mode. So right. Actually stopping to think about why I'm teaching and what I like about teaching. Seems like a portfolio would be good. Making a portfolio would be a good time to do that.
Absolutely. That's really beautiful. And Tabitha adds, to reflect on our teaching and improve. So folks in their introductions talked about, you know, appointment or promotion or tenure or things like that. But there's more than one reason, right? Part of it is we do have to submit them for different reasons, but also they are tenure, promotion, job applications, awards, whatever you might be applying to, but also to improve and reflect on our teaching. So what some things that you can accomplish with the teaching portfolio, it is a record. It can be a record of teaching effectiveness. So we think of these documents as changing over time. So over time, the portfolio helps you look back on your teaching and reflect on it and refine your practices and think about what can be improved and what changes you made that went well. It helps you track some development as a teaching professional over time. Maybe over time you learn new frameworks, integrate new strategies. Maybe you read something that really influences your perspective or you go to a workshop, right? You can document that. And you can share a public representation of yourself as a teacher with students and colleagues. So it's something that you can share with others, right? To show your relationship to the task of teaching. And then we have a little note here on the side. So there's different formats that you can do. You can submit it or produce your teaching portfolio in. And I would say there's no right answer. It really depends on what you're submitting to and what you want to accomplish with your submission. The most familiar one to you probably is a continuous PDF document, but there are also options like building your own personal website, which has its own benefits, but also drawbacks, right? And then you could do a combination of PDFs and an e-portfolio. So it really depends on what you want to achieve with your portfolio, and maybe the format changes over time or based on what you're submitting it to. But a big takeaway for us here is keeping in mind process and product. So a little note is going to show about that.
And just a side note really quick to everyone in the audience, I got a private message. So you will be getting a copy of the slides after the presentation. We also, a little bit further into the workshop, we'll be giving you a guided worksheet so that you have something to interact with to help you think through all these things and answer these questions for yourself. So for those of you who are rapidly taking notes, just know that you'll be getting lots of resources from us very shortly.
Thank you, Hannah. That's a really good reminder. We still have a few people trickling in, which is great. Okay, so components of the AU portfolio. So what would we typically expect to see in an AU portfolio? Well, you always want to have a table of contents, right? You're handing people a big pile of documents or a lot of pages or something like that. Something I like to say is like, lessen the burden on the audience. So as much as possible, make it easy for them to navigate. Sorry about that. I took us a little backwards. But yeah, next up we have teaching philosophy. And this is kind of, I mean, I guess maybe somewhere someone does a teaching portfolio without the philosophy, but the philosophy is really central to the portfolio. It's really important. And that's why we're going to talk so much about it as part of this conversation. But it is tends to be the central document or artifact in a portfolio. We also have assessment sections. So we want to show how we assess our teaching, what kind of feedback we get about our teaching, what we improve. So you've got different types of assessment, like self-assessment, right? Your reflections on your own teaching and progress. Peer assessment, like if you bring another instructor into the classroom with you to give you feedback or to look at a syllabus with you, something like that. And then of course, student assessment, which is not limited to just SATs, can also include things like midterm feedback survey, which is a service that we offer to instructors, collecting midterm feedback, or it could be correspondence where, a comment that a student writes somewhere, or it could even be student work in different ways. So there's a lot of different forms of assessment to consider.
And the end of the workshop will go into a lot more detail about each of these three. So this is Shed introducing them now.
And I remember to turn on the captions a little too late. So my apologies for the delay there. And then supporting materials, which you may also be called like, you may also hear referred to as like artifacts, but basically something like a syllabi or student feedback reports, certificates, different artifacts or materials that point to your growth as an instructor, that support the philosophy that you put out there in your teaching philosophy, that show some of the effectiveness of your strategies, whatever helps you tell the story of your portfolio. And then an optional component are reflections and future goals. To talk about, reflection is going to be part of all of it, but to talk about where you have been and how you've improved, you can also talk about where you're going, how you want to improve in your teaching in the future, a course you might want to teach, a framework you want to experiment, a strategy that you want to try. Those are all things that you can talk about, which will, of course, show the audience that you're committed to being a great teacher, improving as a teacher over time, right? You're not done now. You haven't become the best version of, your teaching. You're going to keep improving and changing over time. So, of course, one size does not fit all. Expectations are going to vary by department and field. So I wish we could give you a template, right? But it's going to look different in your discipline, in your unit, in your department. So it's really important to talk to folks around you and get their input, especially if you know folks who are going to be evaluating, what do they think is important? And then one other note here. Okay. So the process of creating a portfolio. All right. So there's sort of like two different processes that we are going to lay out here. And one is developing a teaching statement. So if you were going to start with developing with the process of creating a portfolio, if you're going to start with developing a teaching philosophy statement, then you're going to gather and select some evidence and artifacts to support your philosophy, to support the big statement you're making about how you teach and why you teach the way you do. Then you can write some section summaries that you can add on to that. And then you can arrange and organize the contents. That's a very sort of linear, sort of like A to B to C to D way of organizing your portfolio. Another way to think about it, though, which is illustrated by the second diagram, is it's cyclical, basically. It's an ongoing process. So where do you start? Wherever you are in the process, right? But the idea is we keep doing it over time. Think of your portfolio as a living document. It's never perfect. It's never done. We will submit it, but we're always going to keep improving it. So maybe you start with this sort of process on the left, but then you got to go back and reflect again, right? We may have new evidence, or we may have new materials to include, or maybe you tried something new and you want to write about that. You taught a new class. So we want you to think of it as, right, an ongoing process. You're always getting better. You're always incorporating new feedback and perspectives. Hannah and Gavin, anything you want to add here about the process?
I don't think so, Shed. I think we'll be getting into each of these steps in a little bit more detail going forward. So if folks have questions about the individual steps, they'll be able to ask them then.
Sounds good.
All right.
Hannah,
if you would be so kind as to proceed to the next slide. Thank you, Shed, for that lovely introduction, the overview of the overall teaching portfolio. Now we'd like to take a step back and invite you all to reflect upon your teaching practice. What words would you use to describe your goals as an instructor? Please, if you wouldn't mind, take a moment to enter those into the chat. And I imagine these will mostly be adjectives, but they could be nouns, I suppose. Better connection with students. Creating opportunities for students to learn content in ways that are meaningful to them. Having that personal connection with students, between students and the material. I think every instructor strives for that, although some subjects are a little bit more amenable to it than others. Having students learn critical thinking skills, content, and have experiential learning opportunities. Very good point, Jason. That's some good student engagement. That's some student-centered approach to learning. Elizabeth says, have students learn the material, learn about themselves as learners, and increase their confidence. That's very good, thinking about not just their ability to learn the material in this one class, but thinking about their overall development as students. So I think these are all great points. And I think it's important to take this big picture look at your own teaching practices, because ultimately what you're going to be doing as you proceed to develop your teaching portfolio is think about your goals as an instructor and how these practices, how these instructional techniques that you've developed in your courses apply to these larger goals. Even if you haven't formally written it down, every one of you already has a philosophy about teaching, a set of values and beliefs from which you derive your goals for yourself and the courses you teach. And if you would be so kind as to proceed to the next slide. So in a nutshell, a teaching philosophy statement is a brief document. It's typically about 1 to 2 pages, single-spaced, in which you articulate your beliefs about teaching and learning, along with examples of how you enact those beliefs in the classroom. So it is the foundation of your teaching portfolio, and the beliefs you articulate there should inform the strategies you adopt in your courses. The good news is that this is not an article, and therefore you do not necessarily need to include, you know, heavy citations for all of the beliefs that you have. You know, I'm sure that if you do have beliefs, that some of them are based in research, but they don't necessarily need to be, because a lot of the point of a teaching philosophy statement is that it's a personal narrative. You should be writing this in the first person voice. The reader is interested in why you care about teaching, what you hope students will gain from taking your classes, and what taking a class with you might be like. At its best, a teaching philosophy statement provides a clear clear idea of what taking a class with you would be like as a student. So I'll be going into the individual components of a teaching philosophy statement in a moment. So Hannah, would you please proceed to the next slide? There they are. So the key components of a teaching philosophy statement are, as it says here, a declaration of your beliefs, that is to say, what values concerning teaching and learning you have, It includes an explanation of the instructional strategies you employ to enact those beliefs, i.e., what do you do? It will include your assessment of the impact your instructional strategies have on learners and yourself. And it will include your goals for the future. How will you improve? Let's talk a little bit more about each of these components and what questions you might ask yourself as you prepare to write your teaching philosophy statement. Hannah, next slide. But first, now's my chance to share this handy dandy worksheet in the chat, which you all will hopefully be able to access. Need to make sure that everyone receives it. And boop. Please let me know if you are unable to access that. But that is a worksheet that Shed, Hannah, and myself developed. It is entirely for your use, so feel free to use it or not use it, however you like. It is a space for you to brainstorm your teaching philosophy statement and your overall teaching portfolio. It includes, as the image indicates, sections for each of these different components that I will be outlining here. So as I go through them, feel free to jot down notes if you're so inclined, or just sit back and take it all in and fill it out later. Hannah, would you be so kind as to move on to the next slide? So, as I said, a good place to begin with a teaching philosophy statement is, what are your beliefs? That is to say, you know, not just what are my beliefs about teaching, but why do I hold those beliefs? What or who has informed my teaching approaches? That's a point where you could include citations to research if you are so inclined. And how have my beliefs been influenced by scholarly teaching and literature? This section of your statement is an excellent place to include some references, but remember that this is not an article. As I've said before, this is the place for you to write about your personal identity as an instructor and how your teaching practices are a reflection of that. Next slide, please. So once you've identified your beliefs about teaching, then is the time to get into your strategies. So you might start by asking yourself, what teaching and learning strategies do I use, and why do I use these approaches as opposed to others? That follow-up question is critical. Essentially, folks understand that you believe that inclusive education is important. But they really want to know not only just, you know, why you believe that, but what are you doing in the classroom to demonstrate that this is important to you? How do you act on those beliefs? Consider how these strategies align with your beliefs, and why use those as strategies as opposed to others. So if you were to say, annotate your syllabus, create an annotated syllabus so that students were able to identify exactly why you were teaching in a particular manner, you know, that is one strategy you could approach to provide more transparency to students. But why would you choose that one as opposed to, say, a more detailed rubric in your class, you know, or why not both? Ultimately, this is an opportunity for you to explain the strategies that you choose, but also why those strategies were significant to you and why you chose them as opposed to others. And I'll add here, don't forget to take pride in the strategies that you found to be particularly effective. This is also a space where you can say that your teaching practices were successful or not, or if they didn't turn out to be successful, that could be an area of which you could reflect and say, well, I attempted to incorporate these strategies, but I anticipate continuing to develop them over time because I have a dedicated interest in ensuring that my classrooms are an inclusive and welcoming space. And this gets us to the next slide, impact. So the third component of a teaching philosophy statement, impact, is, as you might guess, what difference have I made to my students and how do I know? So some questions you could use to identify that would be, how do your students perceive your instruction and the classroom, and how do you know? It might also be helpful to consider the learning outcomes for your courses. So what do your students leave your course knowing, thinking, or being able to do? And perhaps most important, what methods do you use to evaluate your impact? What evidence do you have to support your statements? As you might have guessed by the repeated questions of how do you know in this slide, each assertion of impact should be accompanied by appropriate evidence. We'll talk more about strategies for collecting evidence later in this workshop. But for now, just keep in mind that if you are going to demonstrate that you have beliefs and strategies to enact these beliefs, you also have to be able to say that these have had an impact or not. And finally, the fourth component of a teaching philosophy statement is your future goals. It is perfectly reasonable that you are not at your perfect self at this moment, that you have not attained the ultimate mastery of teaching. And as such, it is expected that you will have goals for yourself, things that you hope to accomplish. So this is a section of the philosophy statement in which you are going to articulate your plans for developing, growing, and improving as an educator. This is probably going to be a fairly simple question for most of you to answer because you're the kind of folks who attend CTRL workshops. But, if it helps, you might take a moment to consider what your future goals and aspirations are, or should I say what your future goals and aspirations have been in the past and whether you have succeeded in meeting them. And if you have met them already, consider the evolution of those goals and how past goals can sometimes be changed into a continuing effort to improve. Even if you have succeeded in meeting the expectations of one cohort of students, does not necessarily mean that every cohort of students will respond to the same instructional strategies. So perhaps a future goal could be, I seek to continue to provide an inclusive, welcoming environment for students as students' expectations for what that environment is changes from course to course. And I'll note here that you can expand your explanation for your future goals by creating an entire section in the complete portfolio dedicated to that subject, should you desire to do so. And next slide, please, Hannah. So now that you've had this worksheet, and we've talked a little bit about the components of a teaching portfolio, teaching portfolio and specifically the teaching philosophy statement, we'd like to give you the next 10 minutes or so to reflect, regroup, and respond to some of the prompts on the first page. Consider how you might describe your beliefs, strategies, impact, and future goals in the teaching philosophy statement. You're welcome to turn off your camera if you so choose. And we will return in 10 minutes, which is, I believe, at 3:10. Now that you've had a chance to think about how you might compose your teaching philosophy statement, we'd like to give you an opportunity to discuss your ideas with your peers. So you know what that means. We're going to assign you into breakout rooms of 3 to 4 people per room. Once you're in the room, please introduce yourself by sharing your name, your department, and whether or not you've written a teaching philosophy statement before. And that's it. After introductions, we prepared a few prompts to get you get your conversation about teaching philosophy statements started. So what key beliefs do I hold about teaching and learning in my context? And what matters most to me? What do I want readers of my teaching philosophy statement to remember about my beliefs about teaching practices? And what strategies do I employ? And what impact have they had? And how do I know? Thank you, Hannah, for sharing those in the chat. We'll call you back from your rooms at, Shed, Hannah, how much time should we give them?
I think I'm going to set it for about 15 minutes.
Sounds good. Okay.
So we'll go with 15 minutes.
Some interesting or thoughtful moments in your discussions. So to debrief this section, I actually want to hear what questions you have about the teaching statement at this point. And some of them may be covered in our upcoming slides, but that's okay. So what questions do we have about writing the teaching philosophy right now? Feel free to share in the chat or to raise your hand. Yes, Steve, go ahead.
Hi, thank you. Thank you. First off, Gavin, Shed, Hannah, getting a lot out of this, so thank you very much. The question I had, so I teach in the AU online program. Been with AU since early 2019. That said, just retired last year after 28 years as an officer in the United mm-hmm. States Navy. And I've been applying to various AU and other schools looking to get a more permanent teaching job here. The application process has been a little bit frustrating in no large part because it's so opaque. So for things like a teaching statement, I'm wondering if anybody can shed some light on the standard that my teaching statement is assessed against. First off, second, who makes that assessment? And third, you know, given the 37 documents that I have to submit every time I apply for a job, how much does a document like the teaching statement, what's its weighting? Along with all the other things you're submitting. I'm just wondering a little bit, I guess, beyond simply how to put one together, but I'm just wondering if anybody could shed some light on this.
So these are really good questions, and I think I want us to address them in reverse order, if that's okay. So, or maybe we'll start with the second and third one, because we have an example of a sort of structure of a teaching statement that we want to share with you all, rather than real examples that folks might have. We're going to show you what a structure can look like. About the question of who evaluates and how much it's weighted, I think is going to vary very widely from unit to unit. Hannah and Gavin, you have been at AU longer, so I'm curious to know what you think in terms of those two questions of who's evaluating it and then how much are different components weighted, I guess.
Hannah, is it all right if I answer first? So first of all, I'll say thank you for your service. And secondly, the in terms of who is evaluating you is really going to be department to department, or as Shed said, unit to unit. AU has given these broad guidelines about what a teaching portfolio should include. And it is really up to each department or unit to interpret those guidelines and to set its own standards for how those should be followed. So in terms of the weight given to your teaching philosophy statement within the portfolio, I would say, like any job, it's a question of, well, how much weight is given to a certain degree of experience in this regard versus another. It's going to really be up to the people that are reviewing your portfolio. I know that's not very helpful, but in many instances, I think if you were transparent and asked in advance, is there any particular format that you want my portfolio to be in? Is there a preferred standard for how it should be structured? As Shed pointed out, we're going to offer a potential structure that you could employ when you're writing your philosophy statement. But every department is different. And so when you go to apply for a position within a department, at AU at least, I can't speak to other institutions, but at AU, you are welcome to ask the department if they have a set standard for their portfolio that they would like you to match. Hannah, do you have any other thoughts on that?
I was going to ask if there's anyone in the room who's been through a process like this or plays a role in evaluating and could shed some light on. So I was gonna say Nate brought that up earlier in the chat. So Nate, do you have anything to share? Some insights for us?
Just to say it again, Steve, where are you? Which school?
School of International Graduate Studies. I'm in their online program.
Yeah. So great. So I obviously, I'm in the College of Arts and Sciences, so I don't know a lot about SIS. And again, the point you were trying to make is you were trying to get make sure that your teaching portfolio for a job application for a full-time position at SIS, right? Yeah. I mean, okay. So I know when we do a full-time search, we really do get a fair number of applications typically. And if I was going to be totally honest, the first read of the teaching statement is really just a flag that the person hasn't said something wrong, right? Hasn't said something that is really, just like something that is so clearly not aligned with what we expect for teaching in our department, right? Something of like in our department, if somebody emphasizes, and this is going to trigger some of you. If somebody emphasizes rigor, is like, oh, I want my, like, we're just like, that's not a good vibe. That's not a good vibe for us, right? So they're going to be looking for just a very general overall fit. And they're really looking to throw people out the pile, right? It's only then if you make the short list, then people will review it to actually think about then. But by that point, they're probably going to be gaining information from other things. So I admit this is a cynical view of the teaching portfolio for the job application. It's so many of them are so generic. So if something very early can stand out that like, oh, I actually will read more of this, many of them will be skimmed just to make sure the person doesn't say outrageous things until they get to a much higher stage. Typically a committee, right? Our committees are typically six people, but we often divide it. So maybe only two people read each one at the first go. So it really is, you want to try to hook at the beginning to get a little of attention, and you just don't want to say anything wacky.
I think that's actually a great lead in into the next slide Shed was going to present, which is a way of organizing it where we did also recommend exactly what Nate just said. Starting with a hook and outlining it. Well, I'll let Shed introduce his slide, but there are ways to structure it to kind of draw people to some key points so that even if they are skimming it, they're getting the best version of what you want to express. So Shed, you can say a little bit more about that.
Thanks, Hannah. And thank you also, Nathan. That's really insightful. Like, we rarely get that perspective. And it makes me think we should get it more into some of our programming. That would be really cool. And we're also going to talk about some of those like pitfalls that we want to avoid to kind of help you stay in the pile, I guess you could say, from our perspective. So this is one way to structure your statement. Of course, like we said, everyone's is going to be different. But a basic structure would be to begin with your, of course, an introduction where you introduce yourself. Readers should know within the first paragraph what your discipline is and what type of courses you might teach. You should hook the reader, like Hannah referenced, like sharing a belief that you have, an experience you had, starting with some sort of strong statement, briefly introduce your beliefs to sort of preview them for the audience that you're going to come back around and talk more about those beliefs. And this is sort of like that classic essay structure that, a lot of us are probably familiar with, or we try and teach some of our students out of that mindset sometimes because they've been really indoctrinated to it. But you would have 3 to 4 body paragraphs, and each one would represent a belief. So again, if that's going to be 2 paragraphs, that's not against any big rule or anything like that. It's the story you're telling. And you start by stating your belief in each paragraph. And then, of course, you support it with your strategies and impact. So Gavin mentioned earlier, belief, strategies, impact. Every paragraph reinforces that belief, strategy, impact. So what I believe, how I enact it, how I make it real for students, how I bring that belief to my teaching, and then how I know it has an impact, or how I know it works, how I know it, you know, it benefits students, or how I saw it didn't, and then I improved it. So examples from your practice, assessment and evidence from your teaching. And then you can conclude by summarizing your main points, sort of tying everything together. And then to sort of give more purpose to that conclusion, you can share your future goals that we talked about. Like maybe you want to talk about future disciplines or courses you want to teach, frameworks you want to try, etc. So let me take a pause here because I just shared a lot of info about questions or thoughts on this this example structure for a statement. And if you want to share them in the chat or personally message them, please feel free. We're really happy to answer them. And I'm allergic to the state of Maryland, and I think we can go to the next slide. Excuse me. Excellent. So if you still do have questions, please do share. But here's where I want to share some of those statement do's and don'ts. And so here's some stuff I want to discourage you from including. Again, nothing is a, you know, every field is different. Every discipline is different. But generally, when we're looking at sort of practices for the teaching statement, we want to avoid, of course, any vague statements. This is your story. It's about you and your perspective. So, right, use that I statement, talk about what you believe, and try not to use what I would call hesitating language, like I try to, I may, I attempt, and try to bring that confidence of like, this is exactly what I do in my classroom, and here's how I know it works. Trying not to use unsupported claims. We always want to include evidence. So whenever you make a claim about your teaching, you know, tell us how you know that, right? I use this strategy, and then tell us what that looks like. So, you know, student testimony, right, from the SAT, or grades, how the grades were impacted, or some really cool assignments students turned in. Of course, we want to avoid negativity towards others. So this is sort of a common pitfall we might see in a statement is a person might say, I never use lecturing because it's outdated. Well, maybe a person who's reading your portfolio loves lecturing and thinks it's a great strategy. So instead, speak about what you know is true from your experience. I know that lecture works well when I balance it with activities with my students, right? So trying not to impugn anyone else's teaching strategies, instead focus on what you can speak to from your experience that works. Of course, Gavin mentioned earlier, it's not quite an academic paper, right? Or impugn the student. Thank you, Nathan. Absolutely. We don't want an overabundance of citations. This is, again, another discipline-specific sort of thing. Maybe if you are in a field like maybe in education, you might include more citations because that's literally the research that you do is education. But we don't want to see anything like, you know, a huge list of references at the end. They should be pretty sparse. Again, this is your story or a summary of your CV. Often we might see folks just kind of list everything they ever taught. But your CV already does that. So there's no need to do that in the portfolio. This is where your voice gets to come through. So your teaching philosophy statement, it should be specific. It should be positive. It's about assets, discoveries, growth, and it should be very personal. So you should be using I statements. You should be talking about what you've witnessed and experienced. And another quick thing I'm going to add here that I forgot to put in the slides is to start with your own voice. I see a lot of people open their teaching statements with quotes from other people, but it's your statement. So start with your own voice, bring the person's quote in later. That's just a personal preference that I have, but just thought I would throw it out there. If I'm reading your statement, I want to hear from you, right? Yeah. So I think we can move on to our next slide. Here are some key takeaways, and I encourage you again to share your questions before we move on. So when it comes to your teaching philosophy, you want to include your beliefs, your strategies, your impact, and then your future goals in your statement. You want to back up your claims with rich examples from your experience, and you want to try and make it personal, right? Because it really is about you and your journey. So even if in your field, it's, you know, you tend to use the passive voice in all of your writing, you might want to really think about, you know, how can I make the passive voice may not be appropriate for this teaching philosophy, right? I have to take accountability for my teaching and tell my story. It's got to be personal, active voice, right? So please share other questions that you have about the teaching statement component. I will give us a minute for that, and you can share in the chat or raise your hand. And a good question to think about here that Hannah had noted that I really love is, if you were assigned to read it, that teaching statement, would you find it interesting? Hopefully so. Yeah, go ahead, Jessica. Oh, you're muted.
I wanted to ask if you had some challenging semesters along the way that you sort of overcame.
Yeah.
We should include some of that, maybe.
I think that's a great idea. I think it's, you know, you probably don't want to dwell on it too, you know, on any sort of challenges or hurdles too much. But that actually brings me to a great point, which is, I think we often think that teaching philosophy has to show that we're like a perfect, excellent teacher with no flaws. But actually, your statement can really be enriched by pointing to times that you improved. So, right, every class is not going to be perfect. So you could talk about a time that, you know, you learned from student feedback and you incorporated it, and then it went really well. Like, that's a great story to read in a teaching statement. So if you can talk about a time that you had a challenge and point to how you used feedback from a peer or from reflection or from student feedback to improve it, and then you saw the evidence of that working, that's beautiful. So I say, yeah, definitely. Hannah, Gavin, anything you would add here or other thoughts on that?
No, I don't think so. I just, I think you already mentioned the shed, but making sure not to blame students for poor experiences or anything of that sort. I think that would definitely be the red flag, the kind of red flag that Nate was talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think to build off of that, I've seen in many a statement, people not realizing they're using deficit language when they say, I do this because students come unprepared to be in my class, or students typically aren't very good at math, therefore I do this. So although the intent is positive, that deficit framing, so rather, you know, to support students' continued growth as mathematicians, I do this, versus because students are bad at math, I do this, is a better way to frame that. So. And certainly your beliefs might be, Jessica's statement, like, I believe it is important to continuously respond to student feedback. And then you mm-hmm. talk about strategies, ways in which that has happened and how it's impacted you and your teaching. That alone could be a belief itself, or it could just be the context through which you talk about other beliefs. So.
Or future goals.
Yeah. Or future goals.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, go ahead. Thank you for that question, Jessica. I really appreciate that. And a quick note before we move on, it can be really hard to like excavate some of these things. Like, we don't often, sometimes we don't sit down and really think about them. We just kind of go, you know, we have our beliefs and they fuel us and we never wrote them down before. So that's why we're here to help. Is it could take a little work, but that's very normal. It's hard to write. It's hard to write these things the first few times. So yeah, so now I'm going to pass it over and we're going to move on to our next segment here. But again, any questions, please do feel free to share them. And we're happy to respond in the chat.
Right. So, oh, I see.
I had to introduce this. My apologies, Hannah. Is that right?
No. Well, I was seeing a question in the chat that I think is a great question from Steve. Is there a difference between a teaching philosophy statement and a statement of inclusive pedagogy? I'm assuming, Steve, you might have seen, I guess, different phrasing and different job applications or job ads and things. I think Gavin, Shed, and I would agree that these two things are the same, and that because we approach all of our teaching from an inclusive and equitable lens, that this is maybe where some places are going, and that they're just explicitly recognizing that all teaching should be inclusive. Therefore, a teaching statement is a statement of inclusive pedagogy. But if that's not the case for you, and as you're reflecting on your beliefs and you're realizing, you know, inclusion and equity aren't really at the forefront here, and maybe that's a reflection on how to alter and improve some of your beliefs to be better recognizing that. And Nate is saying sometimes job ads want both, which maybe is where it gets into more, your teaching philosophy statement is about, I guess, teaching approaches in your discipline, and then the statement of inclusive pedagogy is more about your specific equity approaches. Is that what you'd say, Nate? Or I'd say they should be one and the same in that.
Yeah, but more and more places are asking for both separately, and it can also be that the other one is a place to talk about your intersections with research and community and service and a lot. Like, in other words, it can be a little bit of a different game.
Yeah, I think that's what Shed is putting in here, and Tabitha also alluded to that a diversity, equity, inclusion, justice statement often goes beyond teaching and gets into mentorship, service, research, interactions with colleagues, all your entire performance as a faculty member.
But is the inclusive pedagogy statement similar to the teaching philosophy in terms of its function? I mean, Nathan explained that one of the first things this does is disqualify people. So that's my question, because frankly, this all seems so enormously subjective, right? And it's ironic to me that under the name of equality and inclusion, we've introduced a filter, right, that has no rubric and is entirely subjective. And this isn't helping me get beyond that belief.
You're absolutely right there. But I guess two things we can offer you. You know that Shed and our team has put together a self-assessment document, right, Shed? And that on our portfolio website for the teaching statement, we put together a resource that you can use as your own rubric. Of course, it's not necessarily the rubric that whoever is reviewing it will use, but we've tried to cover all of the bases there that of things people might be looking for. And then we are also happy to read people's statements for them and give them feedback on things they could revise or improve or add based on our experience, having seen a lot of these, and help people write them.
Shed, thanks. I was just about to ask for the link. You're Johnny on the spot here. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Matt got to it a millisecond before I did, and I should have known because they're always on top of that stuff. So I was going to add, I could talk about this inclusive versus teaching statement thing forever and ever. So I'm going to write some stuff in the chat. But if you have any other questions about it, really happy to talk about it, because like, I think people who ask for diversity statements often don't know what they're asking for, which adds to a lot of the confusion. So I'll pass it to Hannah. I'm going to stop myself and mute myself.
Yeah, you're good. Yeah. So as promised earlier in the workshop, now that we're actually getting close, moving right along through, the thing we want to wrap up with is going over, now that you have your teaching statement, which Shed introduced as is kind of the foundation of the portfolio, then you're now gathering artifacts and evidence to support that, and including additional documents and other ways of assessing yourself. So we talked about before the self-assessment, the peer assessment, and the student assessment. I'll just put this slide up really quick and then go back to the chat. Those are the three sections that the AU format, at least, recommends, and we'll go into details about each of these ones. But before we go into details, love to hear from you all already. How do you currently assess your teaching, or what evidence do you have that your teaching is effective and impactful, or what evidence are you already maybe collecting or trying to collect? So please add ideas into the chat, or I see Jessica has her hand up. I'm happy to hear from you out loud too. Yes, Jessica.
Well, one thing that's really a big indication is if you're getting a lot more feedback or sort of animated responses or engagement. Mm-hmm. So that's one way that I assess myself. The other is the evaluations, but I'd like to do more things along the way mm-hmm. that are more specific and more, you know, sort of micro level, more fine tuned.
Yeah, yeah. So what I hear from what you were saying is first, we all kind of informally assess our own teaching based on what our students are doing, how involved are they, how much are they participating, how much are they talking, what are they talking about? And a lot of that, you know, happens informally on an ongoing basis as we're teaching. And then we also at the end of the semester get the formal SETs, but there are so many things in between that we can be doing that are maybe a little bit more formal than just recognizing what's going on in the moment, but not as formal as waiting until the end of the semester for that institutionally run assessment tool. Mm-hmm. So any other thoughts? I saw Tabitha put in the chat mentioning the SETs, but also reflection papers at the end of the course. So certainly student work helps us to assess our teaching, and student work that is designed for reflection and designed for assessment can be really useful. Any other thoughts before I start to share all the things that we recommend? Tiana, I hope I'm pronouncing your name right, wrote in the chat, lots of things related to student feedback, both verbal and anonymous mid-semester. We'll talk about the value of mid-semester feedback. And then the self and peer assessment, something they're looking to add. Great, so yes, we'll go through these three different categories. So I believe the AU Beyond SETs Task Force recommendations note that you should have at least one item in each of these categories. And these categories are then separate from the teaching statement itself. And then your SETs are also separate. So these are all the things that you're doing beyond the SETs and beyond the teaching statement. So three other categories. So that self-assessment category, here are some things you might consider including in there. Again, when you're making decisions about what to include, this might be an opportunity to ask others in your department or ask the people who will be assessing this, what are your preferences or what is our departmental norm? Is everybody in our department expected to do a reflection on their professional development, or do we have a choice? Is it really up to us and what we think represents our teaching best? So some of the things that we have resources around that you can add to this section are an annotated syllabus. So what that means is you take the syllabus from your course and then you kind of leave comments on it, say as if you were passing it off to another instructor to just explain all the things you're doing. So everywhere from your learning outcomes or your course policies or your schedule or the selected readings you have in your syllabus, writing little notes in there like, you know, I choose to have a very flexible attendance policy because I think it's important to be responsive to students' life circumstances. Or a little note under, say, a certain week's reading saying, I added this reading because I wanted to diversify the voices and representation of scholars in the field, and I'm adding in additional content to do that. So in the annotated syllabus, writing little notes to speak to your course design decisions. The self-evaluation of a recording of teaching, not as common, but something you might consider doing and some people find really helpful is to record yourself teaching and then write about it. So reflect on what you saw, reflect on what you noticed, what you now have realized based on what you saw in that recording and what you would want to do differently. So kind of you're self-assessing your own teaching through a video. You could write a narrative of changes made to a course, which could be kind of part of your annotated syllabus or could be something separate. I know instructors did a lot of this, especially at the turn of kind of at the start of the pandemic when switching their courses to fully online. Have written narratives about, you know, I completely redesigned this course after moving it to fully online. And now I've decided to keep these things because of this reason. And this is the impact I saw on student learning, so on and so forth. And then something else you might include in self-assessment is a reflection on your own professional development or a list of things that you've done, maybe a list of things you've done with CTRL or a list of a reflection on some other workshops or outside external trainings you've done in teaching or other teaching related professional development. So to kind of expand on that, we have different categories of professional development, and this is a catch-all category. It could change completely based on your experiences. You might have all of these things. You might have none of the above. If you're in a more teaching adjacent field like education or even policy, sociology, you might have presentations and publications related to teaching. So if you do include a professional development section, you just make that work for you. So there's categories like training, with workshops, webinars, consultations, or conferences you've attended, mentorship, so if you've done any formal supervising or informal collaborations with students, or awards that you've received related to teaching. Then in this peer assessment category, we have a few options there. And please also in the chat, if other things are coming to mind that you think could be added to these categories or questions you have about any of these, let us know. So for peer assessment, you might choose to do a peer observation where you get together with another instructor and observe each other's courses and give each other feedback on what you saw. We have on our teaching portfolio website some guidance around how to facilitate some peer observations. And this is a big focus of ours going forward. We'll be working on more guidance around this and potentially even helping people to find others who can exchange observations with. And also peer review of course materials. So that might be going back to the annotated syllabus example before, maybe you hand off your syllabus to a peer and ask them to leave comments on your syllabus that say, it's really great how you're varying the types of assessments you're doing, or I love seeing the variety in the readings that you offer. So where they're kind of validating your choices and noticing your choices, pointing out things for you, and maybe also asking you follow-up questions. Why do you have this in this order? Have you thought about starting with this topic versus this topic? And then the last category being student assessment. Last but certainly not least, arguably the most important, lots of options for student assessment. And again, these are all outside of the SCTs. So we might have student feedback surveys throughout the semester, especially a mid-semester survey, but maybe even earlier in the semester. You might include in your portfolio an example of a survey you give at the beginning of the semester to get to know your students and their unique needs and preferences, which is certainly an inclusive strategy. You might run, instead of anonymous surveys, a feedback discussion at some point in the semester, maybe a few weeks in or mid-semester. You set aside 20 or 30 minutes of class to ask your students how things are going, talk through as a class changes you want to make to the course as a community. And then you kind of write up about that conversation for your portfolio. Students' emails or letters. So you could anonymously take, if you say get emails from students at the end of a semester, really thanking you for the course or thanking you for the impact you've had on them, that might be something you include in your portfolio. And then CTRL offers mid-semester course analyses where you can schedule for one of the members of our team to come into your class mid-semester and run a feedback focus group with your students or a feedback discussion with your students. And then we compile the findings from that and meet with you to talk about changes you might want to make to the course, as well as things that your students are really appreciating that you're doing. Shed put in the chat, every semester we do send out a survey to request those MCAs. So that's just something to keep in mind. You'll see that if you're teaching in the fall, sometime around mid to late September. All right, so you'll see in that worksheet that we handed out earlier, that there is a second section on the bottom of the worksheet for some individual planning around your plan for gathering portfolio evidence. So giving you a lot of options here, it's something that might be helpful for you to think through is, when are you going to gather all these things? What might you be doing this summer versus what do you need to wait until you're teaching again to do? So I'll let you all take a few minutes to reflect on all these options and start to draft a plan for yourself so you have that going forward. So we'll come back together in 3-4 minutes. If you want to turn your cameras off, feel free. To get some feedback from your peers, we are going to open breakout rooms again, but if you are someone who would rather than talk to others about this, just continue to think to yourself and do planning to yourself, feel free to stay in the main room. I'll open the rooms, relatively large rooms, so that we know that there will be people in all of the rooms. But again, if you're at the point where you're finding it more valuable to do some self-reflection, we completely understand that, and that works just fine. So I will open the rooms for just 10 minutes. Some prompts you might consider discussing are, what do you plan to include in your self-assessment, peer assessment, or student assessment sections? Which components do you already have? What do you need to create or collect, and how will you go about doing so? Kind of see these breakout rooms as a chance to build some accountability, to get feedback on when to do these things, how to do these things, if other people have already done these things, what they found useful or challenging. So all of those things to think about. So we'll see you back in about 10 minutes to wrap up the workshop, but for now, hopefully get some good insights from your colleagues. Concrete plans and next steps, giving yourself a timeline and some accountability measures moving forward. So something, as we wrap up this session, we're really interested to hear from those that are here. What aspects of the teaching portfolio are you most interested in learning more about? Because this workshop was purposefully designed to be very overarching, to cover the entirety of the teaching portfolio, but we do offer workshops on specific components throughout the semester, and we'll be building out additional resources, trying to compile examples even over time. But it helps us to prioritize what to start with by knowing what you are most interested in. So feel free to add some ideas to the chat, or raise your hand and share, or if you have follow-up questions, that might lead to help us to know what you're interested in learning more about. Feel free to ask those. Maybe some alternative questions are, is there any of these components we introduced today are brand new to you, or something that really sparked your interest that you weren't thinking about previously? I'd be interested to hear that as well.
And if you want to share in the chat, we're happy to answer in the chat too.
Thank you, Tabitha. I think the focus on student assessment here, certainly. I think we do a lot of self-assessment, whether it's formal or informal, but not always collecting student feedback.
And I think it's worth mentioning that the origins of this whole teaching portfolio process came from a faculty senate focus group on SETs and how to address issues surrounding bias in student evaluations of teaching, those summative surveys. I think despite that, there is tremendous value in collecting student feedback and using that feedback to improve your teaching. So finding ways to collect student feedback during the course and to have that be a formative kind of feedback, not just summative.
Well, if you are still thinking, I think Teddy, who's here helping us out with this workshop, is going to drop a link in the chat for a feedback form. So whether you fill that out now or a little bit later as you're reflecting on this workshop and what worked for you and what you might want to see change, you can certainly give us some feedback into that feedback form in terms of what you want to see next from our teaching portfolio resources and programming. Just so you know, as I mentioned before, when Steve brought up, not knowing kind of this uncomfortability around or uncertainty around how are my teaching statements being assessed, we're certainly here to review and help you revise your teaching statements. You can request a consult. We also have plenty of written resources on the Teaching Portfolio Guide. The original Faculty Senate Beyond SETs guidance is what has informed our portfolio guide, and then we have broader teaching resources to help you think about teaching. Anything else from Shed or Gavin or questions from the audience?
I would say thank you so much for being here, and we know it's a process, and it takes a while, and like how we said, it's a living document, sometimes you need support. So please do seek out, reach out to us. We're really happy to help you with these materials and to talk more with you and answer your questions.
And we will also be following up with an email with the slides and the worksheet in case you want to share the worksheet with others who weren't able to make it for especially Nate and others who might be in a similar role to share it with those who you are reviewing and assessing. Great. Thank you all. Have a great week, especially if you're attending more of our events. I know it'll be a long week for some of us. So thank you again for your time.